Good morning, church. Great to see you today. As you're moving about the church, we want to encourage you to please wear your mask. It is important. We want to keep everyone as safe as possible so that we can continue to gather together and worship our Lord and Savior together. Look, we started Sunday school today. It was so good to see everyone back. Look, if you've not joined us for Sunday school yet, contact your Sunday school teacher. I'm sure they'd be glad to answer any questions you may have about it. Look, we're ready for worship. Let's pray so that we can worship our Lord and Savior together. Father, we love you. We thank you. We praise you. Please take this time. Use it for your glory. And we pray this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Let's worship. Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Let's worship.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. It's great to see you all here. Wow, we're filling up the wings a little bit. That's great. Let's stand together as we sing, Blessed Be Your Name. Consider all the
sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away.
Clap of praise this morning. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see everybody here. The scripture reading for today is out of 1 John verses 1 through 5. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so our joy may be complete. This is the message we have. We have heard from Him and proclaimed to you that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. Let's worship.
You may be seated.
Nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence. I've tasted and seen. Yeah. tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit.
Our Father in heaven, we love you. We thank you for Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. And we come before your throne asking that your Spirit would move this morning. Come into this place, Father. Let us sense you in every aspect of the word. Thank you for being here, Father. I pray, God, for those that are out today, our Texas Baptist men that are working in the heat and humility and humidity, and pray, Father, that you would watch over and protect them as they're there, to protect them and make them safe coming home, Father. Thank you for this time of worship, this time that we can come and just bow before you. In Jesus' great name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for being here this morning. What a great opportunity we've had to worship. We continue our series, Be Ready for Battle. And we've been asking the question, are you ready for battle? And if you are ready for battle, have you been putting on the full armor of God? And we've been talking about that armor for several weeks and the spiritual battle that we are in right now. Believe it or not, each and every one of us are in a spiritual battle, and it is literally life and death, to be quite honest with you. And this morning, as we come to our scripture in Ephesians chapter 6, so if you have your Bibles, you can turn there in Ephesians chapter 6. If you've come to that place where you know Jesus, can you remember that time? Whether you were 60 or 6 years old, whatever that time, can you think back to that moment where you put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ and Him alone? I want you to go back there in your memory and in your mind, think about that. Think about that precise moment. It is the greatest moment in anyone's life that has ever put their faith and trust. It's the most important decision that you could ever make, is to put your faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone. Can you think back to that time? Maybe you walked an aisle at church and you took the preacher's hand and you said, I need to ask Jesus into my heart. Or maybe it was you alone in your bedroom, or maybe it was you and your mom and dad sitting on the couch. Whatever that time was, I want you to think about that moment, that one particular time, that moment in history when you trusted in Jesus Christ. You got it embedded in your mind, you remember? Now, I have a question for you. Now, I wonder why the preacher or the church or maybe your parents didn't give you a suit of armor. You ever thought about that? You know, when we become a Christian, why didn't they say, okay, you're in a war now. There's a battle going on. And since there's a battle going on, here's your armor. Here's everything you need to be protected. But it doesn't work like that, does it? See, we don't get a physical suit of armor. What we get is a metaphorical suit of armor. And can you imagine, though, that your preacher comes up to you and says, all right, listen up, recruits. You're now in the army of God, and I need you to put on your belt of truth. And on that belt of truth, don't forget to fasten the breastplate of righteousness, and don't forget to put on your shoes of the readiness of the gospel of peace. And certainly, don't leave your shield of faith behind. But that doesn't happen. It's metaphorical. And we are in a real, although we have a metaphorical suit of armor, we are in a real spiritual battle. And God has given us these metaphorical pieces of armor to protect us in that spiritual battle that we're in. And so if you have your Bibles open, we're in Ephesians chapter 6, beginning in verse 13. And it says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. Now I'm going to stop there for a moment. And I want you to see all of these first three things that we're doing, we're putting them on. We fasten the belt of truth. We put these things on. But in verse 16, it changes. And in verse 16, it says, in all circumstances, it says, take up the gospel, take up the shield of faith. It's something that we pick up. See, all of the other ones seem like they're kind of defensive. We put them on. But this one, it says take up, so that we can use it both for our defense and for our offense. It says, in all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. As we come to this fourth piece of armor, the shield of faith, the first question that we must ask and what comes to mind immediately is, what is the shield of faith? What does it look like? What do you think of when you think of the shield of faith? For most of us, we have these two ideas of the shield of faith. We have this one, which kind of is the medieval shield of faith, right? When you watch, King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table, this is the shield of faith that we think of. But that's not the shield, nor is it this one. Maybe you think of this one. I'm a superhero fan, huh? You got to have Captain America's shield, right? That's the shield of faith. No, that's not what Paul had in mind either when he put these words into writing. He wasn't thinking of Captain America. Instead, he was thinking of the Roman soldier, and he was looking at this shield. Now, this shield is different from the other shields. It's not like the other ones. The other shield, Captain America's shield, the round one is small. You can wield it. You think about the medieval knight shield. It's smaller, and you can use it. Do you know that this shield was 30 inches wide? Okay, now I'm a pretty big boy. But you know what? 30 inches covers me up. And it's 48 inches tall. So it's about that tall. Now, I can't hardly duck anymore. But when I could get behind that thing. And it would protect me. It was made to withstand all kinds of projectiles coming from the enemy. It was made of wood that was then covered with leather, and then it was bound and lined all the way around the edges with metal so that it wouldn't fray or tear apart. It was held together. And when they would go to battle, they would take that shield, they would dip it in water. They would soak that leather in water. So when those fiery arrows and those darts and those spears would come at them, you know, I read a lot about shields this last week. Did you know that history will tell you that after some of the battles that these Roman soldiers went through, they would go back and pull out up to 100 arrows out of one shield. That's amazing, isn't it? That they would have that many arrows in a shield to protect them. So they would dip it in water, and when it would be soaked in water, when that fiery dart, it would go out. It would take that flame and make it useless. But it was able to deflect these projectiles from the enemy soldiers. And these shields, of course, were big enough to hide behind. They were their protection. The shield served two basic functions. The first one we all know is for protection. It's easy to understand when you have this big old shield, you can hide behind it, and it's hard to get through it. But there was a second purpose for the shield. It was a badge of honor. When they would take that shield into battle, it would have the king's insignia or the army that they were fighting for or the country that they were fighting for, and they would have that on their shield. Matter of fact, it says that Spartan moms would tell their children to either bring back their shield or be carried back on it. That's how important the shield was. It was their badge of honor. It means that you, in battle, in the heat of battle, you don't defect. You don't run away. You don't retreat. It says that you stand. And four times in our passage, what does Paul tell us to do? He says to stand and to stand firm. And we are to stand firm with our shield of faith. Either stand with it or die with it is basically what Paul is telling us. And it, see, that is what it is for the Christian. The shield of faith is both our protection, but it is also our badge of honor. Our faith in Jesus Christ is our badge of honor. Our faith is what identifies us as believers in Jesus Christ. And our faith is absolutely essential for our victory in this spiritual battle that we're in. We were supposed to read 1 John chapter 5. It was my fault, not theirs. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 4, it says, "For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world." You know what it says? Our faith. Our faith is the victory that has overcome the world. What do we mean then when we talk about faith? What do we mean when I say the word faith? Let me tell you what faith is not. A lot of people, when you think of faith, and when they think of faith, they think of that phrase, blind faith, or leap of faith. Maybe you think of that. You know that I like action movies, right? I like superhero movies. I like it when the hero always wins. And one of the movies that I really enjoy watching is Indiana Jones. Any Indiana Jones fans out there? In the not one, just me. Okay, thank you. There's some. In Indiana Jones, in The Last Crusade, Indiana Jones and his father, played by Sean Connery, they're on the quest to get the Holy Grail. And as they go through all of these clues, they finally make it to this cave or whatever it is where the Holy Grail is supposed to be. And on their way, of course, there's always the enemy out there. And the enemy shoots Sean Connery. Indiana Jones is dead and he's about to die. And so it's imperative that Indy, I tell you what, just watch the clip.
Hurry! Come quickly!
It's a leap of faith.
Go out. You must believe, boy. You must believe.
There's old Indy. He takes that leap of faith and he steps out on that invisible bridge. You know, when we come to what the Bible talks about faith, it's really not talking about a leap of faith. It's not talking about a blind faith at all, to be quite honest with you. It's not about leaping into nothing. A lot of times that's what people think of faith, that I have to leap into nothing. And that's not the truth at all. Hebrews 11:1 says, "Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen." And Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 5, "For we walk by faith, not by sight." So in that sense, it's true that we don't operate in faith by looking at things that we can see with the physical eye. But that's a far cry from blind faith or just taking a leap of faith. Faith in Scripture is always defined by its object. Let me say that again. Faith in the Bible is always defined by its object. And in this case, our object of faith is what? God Himself. It's the truth of God's Word. It's the Holy Spirit. It is Jesus Christ. That is the object of our faith. Not some blind faith. It's not like me going to the edge of this stadium, this podium here and jumping off. That's not blind faith. Our faith is not blind. It is in the person of Jesus Christ. It's a far, far way from being blind. Faith in Scripture is defined by its object. And Jesus is the object of our faith as revealed in the gospel. So faith derives its strength from its object. So where does our faith come from? Our faith comes from knowing Jesus Christ. So when we're talking about faith, we're not talking about blind faith. We're talking rather about the response of our heart to God through our mind, our heart, and our will. Theologians define it with these three terms: knowledge, assent, and trust. Knowledge, assent, and trust. Knowledge corresponds with the mind. Faith knows something. Faith has to know something in order to be faith. That's the knowledge part of it. It's something that we understand. Faith relies on the sure foundation of God's word. It trusts on God. It trusts his words. Remember, I had told you that every other piece of armor is somehow connected to the belt of truth. And the truth is that the shield of faith is connected to the truth of the gospel, the truth of Scripture. The second, faith also assents to his word. That means that with our hearts, we agree with it. With our hearts, we accept it. We welcome it. We receive it. And then there's trust. That's the act of the will by which we really entrust ourselves to God's truth. Faith involves mind and heart and will and knowing, believing, and trusting in God's word. So we take up the shield of faith when we respond to the truth of Scripture. And what does the truth of Scripture tell us? To put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ and him alone. He has told us over and over again that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through him. Have you taken up the shield of faith? And so if you have, how does that shield of faith protect you? In the same way the shield protected the Roman soldier by ducking behind it, the shield of faith protects the entirety of the Christian. The shield, 30 inches by 48 inches, they weren't my size back in that day. And they could duck behind and it would cover and complete them. The shield of faith completely covers us and we can hide behind it. There are many passages that talk about how faith protects our mind and our heart and our will. Scripture has an emphasis and emphasizes the priority of faith and the necessity of faith and how faith is essential for every aspect of our spiritual lives. The author of Hebrews in Hebrews 11:6 says, "And without faith it is impossible to please him." And if we look over to 1 Peter, Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept for you in heaven." Now listen, he's talking about our salvation, isn't he? That we have faith in a sure, solid foundation of salvation. If you've put your trust in Jesus Christ, your salvation is secure and nobody and nothing can ever take it away from you. Isn't that awesome? But what, look what he says. "And unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time." That word guarded, it's used many times and it's translated as the word shield in other translations. And you know what it stands for? This word guarded, it translates into, and it carries this idea of putting an army garrison around the city to protect it. God, in his great wisdom and mercy and love and grace, has guarded our salvation. It is secure, and nothing can ever take that away from us. Not only does the shield of faith protect our salvation, but it also protects every aspect of our spiritual walk. The shield of faith even protects the other pieces of armor. The shield of faith protects the belt of truth. It protects our righteousness is protected by our faith. Our peace of the gospel is protected by our faith. Faith is essential to our salvation. We are saved by grace through faith. Next week, we'll look at the helmet of salvation, and then we'll look at the sword of the Spirit, which is protected by our faith. Faith is the only appropriate response to the Word of God. It's the only. You cannot read the Word of God and take it in without faith. Someone said, faith is our armor for our armor. So the shield of faith, which is the is our faith, is tried through trials and tribulations. How many of you have ever been through a trial and tribulation? How about right now? I mean, just look around. We're in a trial, and our shield is our faith. Faith that no pandemic can stop the Word of God from moving forward. Faith that no amount of cultural things that are happening in the world around us can stop the Word of God from moving forward. Doesn't matter who's in the White House. Doesn't matter who's in Congress. It doesn't matter who's on the Supreme Court. Listen, we need to vote our conscience in all of those things, but none of those things really matter because we have a living God who is there. And he says that your salvation is true. And he says that every part of your spiritual walk is surrounded and protected and guarded by your faith. Do you have the shield of faith? See, if you have the shield of faith, what is there to worry about? If you have the shield of faith, what is there to be afraid of? Look back in Ephesians chapter 6. In verse 16 again, it says, "In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one." The shield of faith protects us from the flaming darts of the evil one. This should remind every believer listening that we are in a personal spiritual war with an enemy that is malicious and wicked and evil. Satan, the chief of all evil forces, is out there to get us and to destroy us. And the Bible here calls those attacks flaming darts. When you or I think of a flaming dart, we don't think that much about it. I mean, after all, our darts are about this long, right? They're not even as big around as your little finger. I mean, how's that little flaming dart going to hurt you? But let me tell you, that's not what Paul had in mind with this metaphor. When you look up the term flaming dart, it is comprised of two Greek words. The first is pyromania. Can you figure out what word we get from that? Pyromaniac, flaming, fire. The second is belos. That is dart. Or it can mean missile, believe it or not. So when I think that Paul understood how important it is to protect us from the attacks of Satan, did you know that in the United States there are at least 30 different types of missiles? I didn't know that. The United States alone has over 30 different types of missiles that we know of. There may be some we don't know of, right? But we know of about 30 different missiles. There is air-to-air missiles. There are air-to-surface, surface-to-air, surface-to-surface, anti-submarine missiles, ICBM, which means intercontinental ballistic missiles, and submarine-launched missiles. So we can launch a missile from any place in the world, whether we're underwater or on top of a mountain. And these missiles can be guided by GPS or infrared or radar or even wired radar frequencies, believe it or not. One of the biggest missiles in all of the world is the R-36M SS-18 with the nickname Satan. I wonder if they knew. Listen to how big this R-36M SS-18 Satan missile can travel a distance of 9,941 miles. It can carry 550 kilotons of nuclear warhead, and it is accurate within a football field. Now, can you imagine? We can't even hardly drive to Brookshire's and back without getting lost. And here's this missile that can go almost 10,000 miles and hit a football field 10,000 miles away with enough nuclear warhead that could destroy most of Texas. It's unbelievable, isn't it? Now, when we look at this word, flaming darts, in our passage, I think this is what Paul had in mind. He understood the destructive power of Satan and what he throws at us and how deadly and accurate Satan's fiery darts can be. So our shield of faith is absolutely essential to deflect the attacks of the missiles of the enemy. Our faith protects us. So how does it protect us? And what does it protect us from? When Satan throws the dart of doubt, you ever had doubt in your life? Maybe Satan has whispered in your ear, "Hey, listen, you're not good enough. God can't love a person like you. No, you're not saved. There's no way you could be saved. You're just not good enough. You can't really be saved. So what do? When those flames of doubt come flying in, you know what you do? You hold up the shield of faith. You have faith in the Word of God that says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Or how about Romans 8, where Paul says, who shall bring up any charges against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? How can Satan condemn if God justifies? We have God, the Son, praying to God, the Father, on our behalf. Think about that. Jesus, the Son of God, God incarnate, the second person of the Trinity, is standing next to the Father, praying on your behalf. What in the world is there to doubt? Or what is there to be afraid of? That's how you fight the accusations of doubt. You believe the promises of God's words. As a matter of fact, that's how you fight every one of Satan's attacks, with the Word of God. Will God really take care of all my needs? Maybe you've thought about that. You know, I'm getting older, my money is getting thinner, as with my hair. Will God really take care of all of my needs? Well, Philippians 4 says, and my God will supply every need of yours according to His riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Not my riches, but in His. Well, maybe you are discouraged and you feel like God has forsaken you and He's forgotten all about you. Psalm 42:5 says, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? My hope in God, for I shall again praise Him, my salvation and my God. Or here's the dart the enemy is using more and more frequently today. It is the dart of fear. I can't get out of my house, and I can't go to church, and I can't do this, and I can't, and we're afraid, and we're listening, and we're seeing, and we're doing, and we're just afraid. And where do? Is you put up the shield of faith. You put your faith in the promises of God. And the psalmist wrote, when I am afraid, I put my trust in You, Lord. Not in man, not in the news, not in doctors, not even in the church. Or the pastor, or your son, you put your faith in Him alone. Maybe we're afraid of the fear of the unknown. The Bible says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand, Isaiah 46 says. Maybe you fear the loss of a loved one. The author of Hebrews writes, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Maybe you fear old age, our bodies break down, our monies go away, our friends begin to leave us. How in the world do we cope? The Bible says in Isaiah 46, even to your old age I am He, and to gray hairs I will carry you. I have made and I will bear, I will carry and I will save. We lean on Scripture. Some folks fear death itself. Maybe you're one of those. I'm afraid to die. You know what Paul said? For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. What is there to be afraid of? One more. No matter what missile Satan throws at you, remember what the Bible says. It says, little children, you are from God and have overcome them. For He who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Are you a child of God? Have you put your faith and trust in Christ alone? Then greater is He that is in you than anything else. No matter the circumstances, no matter the pandemic, no matter what the bank does or says, no matter who is elected president, no matter any of that stuff, He is greater. Are you a child of God? Have you trusted in Jesus as Lord and Savior? Whatever the missile the enemy hurls at you, fear, despair, temptation, doubt, he says, lean on and hide behind the truth of Scripture. He says, faith is the victory. I'd like to sing that. I tell you what, why don't we stand just Acapulco style, a cappella. Let's stand. Come on, Jason and Lita's. Faith is the victory.
Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. His banner over us is love, our sword, the word of God. We tread the road the saints before with shouts of triumph trod. By faith they like a whirlwind's breath swept o'er on every field. The faith by which they conquer death is still our shining shield. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
If you believe that, say amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Faith is our victory. Wouldn't it be great to know how to take up that shield of faith? Let me give you four quick things. First, you take up the shield of faith by hearing and receiving the word of God. Have you put your faith in Christ? The Bible says, so faith comes from hearing and hearing through the word of Christ. The word of Christ is the gospel. Have you put your faith in the gospel? The good news. You know, the gospel in my mind is Romans 5:8, but God demonstrated his love for us in this while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. He died for you. While you were still a sinner, while you were still an enemy of his, he died for you. That's the gospel. That's the good news. Have you put your faith? Have you heard and put your faith in that good news? Second, pray. And then pray some more. And then pray again. John Calvin wrote, prayer is the chief exercise of faith. Jesus is our great high priest interceding on our behalf. We mentioned this earlier, but in Hebrews 14:16 it says, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We have Jesus Christ standing at the right hand of the Father praying on your behalf. See, what happens? Prayer gives you faith. When you pray something, you're praying by faith, and it strengthens your faith. But here's something even greater to think about. Not just your prayer that is strengthening your faith, but it is the prayer of Jesus Christ in heaven praying for you that should strengthen your faith. Wow. Third, stay committed to fellowship and other believers. Stay committed. The Roman army would interlock their shields. You see how they would do? Listen, if an enemy is over here and they're shooting and they're trying, there's no way an arrow's getting through, right? They're protected. They're protected all the way around. The Bible says, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. And boy, do we see the day drawing near, don't we? Together and united for the single cause of the gospel makes us stronger and less vulnerable to the darts of Satan. We need to stand together. Fourth, make Jesus the object of your faith. That's pretty simple, isn't it? Make Jesus the object of your faith. No one else, not your own strength, not your own wisdom, not how much money you have in the bank. Make Jesus the object of your faith. Listen to what Hebrews 12 says. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Look what it says. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith. Is Jesus the object of your faith? See, faith gets its strength not from itself, not from how strong we are, not by how smart or great or anything else. Our faith gets its strength from our founder and our perfecter, Jesus Christ. So I ask, whether you're sitting in the worship center or you're watching online, is Jesus the founder and protector of your faith? See, if he is not the object, everything else is moot. It doesn't matter. I come this morning because I know whether you're online or maybe even someone sitting in here today, whether you have a crowd this size, let me tell you, a lot of times there are people that are just not saved, that have never really put their faith in Jesus and Him alone. And listen, I would be not a very good preacher or pastor if I let you leave this place without hearing that good news that God loves you. That you are a sinner. That you're an enemy with God. But He made a way. And that way is Jesus Christ. Have you put your faith in Him and Him alone? It's not Jesus and how much money you give. It's not Jesus and how often you come to Sunday school. It's not Jesus and what you do in service for the church. It's not Jesus and anything else. It's Jesus and Him alone. Have you put your faith? Is He your shield? Is He your object? If not, why not make Him that today? Let's stand together. Our Father in heaven, we love you. And thank you for your word. And thank you that Jesus is the object of our faith. In your great name we pray. Let's sing together.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back.
Amen. Were you glad to be here this morning? Yeah, praise God. I tell you what, please be seated for just a moment. We're going to ask that Roy, would you help, and Bill, would you help? Let's release, and James, would you help on that side? The offering is on the way out, so if you want to just slip it in the offering plate on your way out, your tithe and giving. But if you would, we're going to release and dismiss from the back forward. So if you're on the back row, you'll be released first. And then we'll come forward. So if our gentleman would help guide us out of here. Thank you. God bless you.
Well, thank you so much for joining us this morning. It was a pleasure to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with you. If you have any questions about what was talked about in the service this morning, we'd love to talk to you further. You can contact us at hbbc.live. and go to our Contact Us page, or you can contact us on our Facebook page, or you can give the office a call at 903-769-2091. And perhaps today, maybe the Holy Spirit's been speaking to your heart and you'd like to know a little more about what it means to be a Christian and to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. We'd love to talk to you about that and get to know you and maybe even share a meal with you. God bless you. Hope to see you soon.